But did you ever intend in the very beginning in 1963 that your writing would cause a revolution and have the effect it did?
No, not consciously. I would have been terrified. I merely was writing a book, and yet underneath, you know, it's strange. There was this sense of urgency and importance, as if perhaps a part of me knew if I thought about things like destiny, I would think that there was something there.
Yeah. But what was it about you as a person and the kind of life that we were leading that prompted you to write this kind of book?
Well, I was leading the same kind of life that all of us were supposed to be leading in those years, you know, after World War II. I had my children. I'd had a newspaper job and been fired because I was pregnant, but then I would been so guilty working anyway that it was sort of a relief, and I wrote Housewife on the census blank and tried to find this great feminine fulfillment, which I was determined to find. And I had this also thing of my mother having been so frustrated. She had started out being a woman's page editor of the small city, Peoria, Illinois, where I grew up, and then she was married to a businessman, and of course she couldn't work, and she was frustrated about not using her abilities, and she took it out on us and on my father. And then I'd had this good education, and I had the frustrations, I suppose, also of not using it. I was just living the life, but I was also freelancing for women's magazines and helping to create this image of woman that just wasn't true anymore. And somehow it all came together. It all came together in my life. And then I just had this necessity. I had to figure out what the image was and what it was doing and why it was wrong, and I had to come to terms with some truth about my life as a woman.
How did you actually get down to the actual writing of the book? Because you were, as you said, a mother, a busy mother of three children, and so on.
I had my three children. I started work on it actually when my baby, my girl, who's not 21, was just born. And I think everyone was always doing their homework on my table, and my husband would come home and brush the notes off the table. And the public library in New York opened a room where if you were a writer, you could have a desk, and if you were writing a book. And I remember just something new, that I took myself seriously enough as a writer to ask for that desk. And then I would take the bus and I would go in 3 days a week, and I would work took me 5 years. It was supposed to take me one.
Well,
and I'd wheel the baby afterwards. I'd come back, and then they'd come home from school, and I'd wheel the baby and take them all out, and so.
Yeah. Well, when you actually published the book, of course, I mean, it had amazing reaction. It became a world bestseller, and of course, you had bad reaction and good reaction. But what about your family and your friends in the neighborhood that you lived? How did they react?
Well, nobody had said, the publisher only printed a few thousand books. Nobody thought it would have this impact. It was like I said, each woman had been struggling with all these things alone. I mean, if she was a person, if she felt there had to be more somehow than baking bread, or so, she was a freak, there was something wrong with her. But it was like everyone was waiting to have it put into words. And so, of course, this enormous impact happened immediately. But in my own suburb, it was so threatening, you know, to the other women that I had the carpool with for the children when they had to go to dancing school or their lessons or things. And I sort of became a leper, like a pariah. And it was just too threatening at first to some of these other women. Well, later, of course, it all changed. And then I had to move back into the city. I mean, with...
What about the children? Did they have a sort of backlash too from the neighborhood?
Well, I don't know. It's hard to tell what they would tease me. You know, my boys, and I think they were proud of me, but they would tease me. And they don't like to let me know too readily that they're proud of me, you know. But my daughter only recently admitted that she had read my book. You know?
Well, when actually you then became a very famous lady. I mean, very sort of worldwide, and you earned a lot of money, became rich, famous. Did you love
all
that?
Not so rich, more fame than fortune.
Did you love it all, or did you absolutely adore it all? And do you still?
Well, listen, it would be hypocritical to say that one didn't get a kick out of some of it, you know? But it's the whipped cream on the cake. Some of it, well, it's... If you don't have it, you think you want it desperately, but then you have it, and, well, you like part of it, and then it's not very warming, some of it. And,
What are the disadvantages, then? What's not very warming?
Well, I don't know. You see,
being
the most
Betty
important
Friedan.
Thing, the thing that you really wouldn't give up, is that to have been a part of the action, to have this sense, this weird sense that I suddenly realized that I have helped make history, or that I have, that I really am a part of making something happen, and that I've used my life. Do you see? That I've used my life well. I think I have justified my life. You know, see, that's a good feeling. The celebrity part, you know, or that people recognize you and all that. That's embarrassing sometimes, you know, and you just don't know quite how to handle it.
Is it because they've got a preconceived notion of the kind of woman you're likely to be, or you
well,
are?
Well, now that part can be very irritating, you know. I mean, I'm so sick of people, you know, that come up to me and they say, well, I'm not, they say, oh, you don't look a bit like your pictures are, they really say, well, you're not nearly as ugly as we thought you were, or they have this image of me, and this gets in the way terribly in my life with men sometimes, because, you know, I am divorced now, and I have, like, had my second adolescence, and I like men and all that, but this battle axe, you know, battle axe, you know.
Yeah.
Well, I can be a battle axe when I need to be, but I'm much more, you know, I'm
feminine.
Not, that's just sort of the image.
Yeah. You mentioned your divorce there. Do you think that because you have been part of the action, because you have helped start the movement to free yourself and other women, do you think that in a sense too that you've lost, your own life has suffered, your marriage has gone, you've missed out?
That's much too simple. A cliche, it's almost a cliche to say, oh, you know, you have to choose. If there's anything that my work has been about, the feminine mystique and the way it's changed, breaking through it, the way it's changed all our lives to call ourselves person, is that we shouldn't have to make these choices anymore. These, you choose between profession, career, and love, motherhood, marriage. We have to make our lives now, and can, in a much more complex pattern, but it can't always be happiness. I got the courage finally to get out of an impossible marriage, bad marriage, and I held on to it too long because I was afraid of being alone. And I am lonely sometimes now, but I have made my own happiness in unconventional ways, perhaps. I have great satisfaction with my children. I have the love of
Are you totally
man.
Free? are you totally free, though, up here?
No. I wish I were, you see. I have days and hours when I feel marvelous and I really enjoy life, and the movement itself and the change that we've made, and women finding their strength to do these things that we didn't think we were capable of doing. We couldn't have dreamed that we had this, that we could change the possibilities of lives for our daughters and for ourselves, and really has changed everybody's life, as I say in the book. But all of this is exulting. It's an exultant feeling sometimes. But I'm not free. I'm full of doubts. I hate going places alone still. So
yes.
I worry what to wear. I worry what people are going to think of me. I felt awful guilt. My children can make me feel guilty. I mean, you know, still, you know, just the slightest word of disapproval from my children and I wilt, you know. And I find it very hard to disagree with a man I love. You know, I bottle up the anger too much in children. I mean, that sort of thing.
But you, what about your daughter? You say you've made our daughters free. Do you think that your daughter is very different then because of what's happened?
Oh, I think my daughter's wonderful. And
but your daughter meaning her generation? Then,
yes,
you know.
And how
much freer then are
well,
they?
Well, I think they start from a different place than we started. They will not be burdened with as many of these guilts and these conflicts. My daughter just graduated from college and she's going to be a doctor and she's going to medical school. She certainly intends to marry and have children. I don't think she's going to be full of guilts about it. She will have to put it together in her life and make a pattern of it in her own way, but she doesn't have to hide her intelligence or feel that there's a conflict between her intelligence and her femininity. And she does expect to be paid and rewarded and to have the same opportunities that she would a man, and yet she is what you would call very feminine. She feels very good about herself as a woman. I just think she has more life open to her.
And is that the woman, when you started writing that book, is that the woman that you wanted to see of the future? Is that the woman that you were aiming at, almost nearly the blueprint, as it were?
Well, you know, we had to create ourselves as women. We had to create ourselves as new women. that's what all this was about. This was a necessary moment in evolution history. And I had a little daydream, a little fantasy a while ago, and I was thinking about Emily, my daughter, and I saw her in a red strapless velvet dress, a sort of dress that I thought was a very glamorous dress when I was a girl her age. But instead of being shy and awkward and insecure and self-conscious the way I was when she was glowing and she was radiant and she was, you know, free. And I think that's the dream.
But yes, it is a dream, and it is fantasy, and I like that free feeling. But yeah. I, like you, get terrible sort of guilt feelings, because I don't think it's that easy. I think that you have this persona about you. You make us feel as if it is easy. It's not, though.
No.
I mean, a lot of women listening today will say, you know, it takes courage, it takes sacrifice, perhaps, and it's very, very scary.
Well, I think,
and they would blame the movement for an immense amount of friction within the family, perhaps. They would blame Women's Lib. I mean, how would you answer them?
No,
the
no,
people
no,
who say, I don't agree with, I mean, I don't, I'm not bothered about Women's Lib, really. I would believe in equality. But I think it has caused divorce. I think it has caused friction. How would you answer
them? No, I think friction, yes. There's change, and there's enormous disruption with the change, and it does take courage on women's part to move into a new way, and there are no paths and patterns that are so clear anymore. But, and there are problems, and I wouldn't minimize the difficulties, and there will be new problems, but it is much better to move and to become more alive, and to become more truly ourselves. And the family will only benefit from it in the end. Do you know, there was terrible pathology in that hidden violence and that hidden hostilities that our mothers had and our grandmothers had, and they had reason to have them, and they took it out on themselves and their own bodies and self-hatred and headaches. They took it out on the children, and they took it out on the husbands, and they didn't have all that good a life. And it is better to be ourselves, and it will be even better to be our daughters. And the more we can freely be ourselves and find out what we are and not beat ourselves down to be feminine or put on these plastic smiles, the freer we are, I think, to love men, to let men be what they are, and to let our children be what they are, and to love our children, and to take joy in life, and
but men have got to change too.
Oh, yes,
Becky,
and that's
they?
The next stage. The next.
What's that then? You tell me then what
well,
men
the next,
are
the next has to be, you see, this first stage, when I said no to the feminine mystique, and then we have to say no to sex discrimination, as we did
yes,
in the women's
right.
movement. And now I think we've just about come to the end of having to say all these no's. We have to put it together for a new yes. We have to put it all together, make it work for us in life, create the new patterns. You know, it doesn't mean that we give up the home, but it has to be a different kind of home. We can't just keep the same standards of complete perfection in the home that we used to have. And the work has to be shared differently. Husband, wife, children, or even if you live alone, you still have a... Well, we don't stop cooking necessarily, but we don't cook as slaves anymore, and we can eat out with a freer feeling.
But don't you think that men still feel a bit threatened, and that they feel that, I mean, that they said that they lose their masculinity?
I know a lot of men that feel quite enlivened and liberated by the change in the U.S., at least, as many men support the basic goals of equality as women, and I think that men are less threatened by it than some women. I think it's wrong that men have died 10 years younger than their wives in recent generations from all the pressures and the ulcers and the strokes of the tears and the feelings that they have to suppress to be masculine, and that they have to be so big and brave and dominant and superior all the time, and then the guilts and the hostilities and the burdens and the naggings of the women, and that it will be liberating for men to be able to be themselves and to share the thing more. And then I think in the end, you know, as the kids used to say, we will all be freer to make love, not war.
Well, you know, the thing that the book, which I must say is a very good read, and if anybody didn't know how the movement sort of started in America, it certainly is very lively and very humorous. But a chapter I enjoyed very much was how you described the sort of almost the workings of the NOW movement, the National Organization for Women. And you seem disturbed at the infighting that's going on there. And it seems to me a lot of bad publicity came for women's liberation through the extremist movements and the kind of things that they, the issues that they wanted to take up. Would you agree, is it in fact that they did the movement a great deal of harm?
Well, I'd almost put the finger more on the media in a way. Any movement has extremists. The media picks on the extremists and the exhibitionists because it makes more startling news. There was a lot of rage in women, and it had been suppressed, and then it came out. And I think, and I always took issue with what I called the pseudo-radical extremists that tried to translate that rage into some permanent ideology of sexual warfare, and that seemed to say, down with men, down with marriage, down with children, down with home. I didn't think that was what it was all about at all, that what we really were all about was just that women must be people now, can be people now, therefore are entitled to the equality of opportunity and their own voice, and then they must put it together and are free to put it together in a better kind of home and family and motherhood and a choice of motherhood and love and the rest. Well, yes, of course, the extremist...
Well, we know when you think they took up issues like, you know, lesbianism and
much too much focus on that kind of issue and for what it was really all about. But though the rights of anybody to sexual choice, sexual privacy, one doesn't deny. But that's not the main thrust of the women's movement. The main thrust of it is just the personhood of women and equality. And women live a life, most of them, with men, have to deal with men, work with men, love men if we can, you know. they're here to stay. And the next stage of it, you see, the men will be... But you see, you couldn't... expect a movement as large as this not to have differences, and women were unused to power, and there was a desperate hunger for power in women, and then to get used to it, and to even some of the battling. We shouldn't have tried to suppress the battles as much
as
we did. Because you had to, there were differences between me and the extremists that I should have articulated more boldly than I did, not less. But, you know, sisterhood, it was so important to have that solidarity of women together that we tended to try to play down the differences where perhaps we should have faced them more honestly. But now I think we come out to see that in this last 15 years or so, is wonderful.
Well, Betty, I hate to interrupt you, but I was going to ask you if you're ever going to be sick of it all. I don't think you ever will. Thank you very much, Betty Friedan, for talking to us today.